where we are today. We've been talking over the last 3 to 4 weeks about the words that we speak and the power and the authority and the effect of the words of our mouth. And we talked originally about listening, stop and taking a listen to the words that we've been talking, because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So in other words, whatever we're speaking is coming from our heart, so we can learn something about our heart by listening to the words that we've been speaking. Then we talked a little bit about words that are spoken in the flesh as opposed to words that are spoken in the spirit. Words guided by God versus words coming out of our own heart and our own self. And then we talked a little bit about words of agreement. What happens when we agree with God about us? If God declares something about us and we come into agreement with it, we're bringing the supernatural into agreement here on earth and the natural, and there's a real power and authority. And then last week, we talked about the word was living. And the word was active, and it was sharper than a two-edged sword, that it could actually divide our soul and our spirit, that which is of God and that which is of us, the bone and the marrow, that which is on the outside versus that which is on the inside, and our thoughts and intentions. Why do we think the things we do? Because the intent of our heart. And it could divide those and show us the difference. And we're in a Sunday right now that we know in the Christian circles as Palm Sunday. And Palm Sunday revolves around the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, where he comes in on a donkey and he is having people just praise his name and shout out Hosanna and lay palm branches down in their coats, and he's walking over them. But there's something he says about words in that triumphal entry that I thought was meaningful for today. It's in Luke 19:39. While all of this is going on, some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." But Jesus answered and said, "I tell you, if they become silent, the rocks will cry out." So what he was saying is, hey, the word is going to be spoken. And if you shut their mouths, even the rocks will begin to speak out, because that word has to go forth. So we know that Jesus was a man who truly knew how to speak. His words were powerful. His words were important. Matter of fact, at one time, they were so important that he was speaking in a place and it got so full, all of the inside, the doors, the doorways outside, so full that some people who wanted a friend of theirs healed had to crawl up on the roof and cut a hole in the roof just to get to him, because the people were packed in so tight. We know that sometimes he spoke and a crowd of 1,000 men plus their families gathered on a hillside to listen to him. And they're so intrigued by what he was saying that they wouldn't even go home and eat. They were hungry, and so they just stayed there to listen to the word. So you know what he was speaking was powerful. We know that he could speak to the religious leaders of the day and just cut them off at the knees, just shut them down from the things they were saying. We know that his words were so powerful that when the centurion came to him, he could speak healing to the centurion's slave. And at the centurion's house, the slave was healed at that very hour because of the power in Jesus' words. We know that he could invite men to come and walk on the water with him, as he did with Peter. We know that he was so powerful that he could speak to a legion of demons and tell them, command them out and to go into the swine, and they would do it. That's how powerful his words were. We know that he can even speak to death in the case of Lazarus and say, come out of that tomb. This is a man who spoke with a great, intense power. So we have no question about the power and the authority of Jesus's words. But today I want to talk to you about the fact that he often spoke without saying a word. And I'm just going to tell you that sometimes the greatest words you will ever say come in the total silence of your behavior. You will speak louder sometimes with your actions than the words that come out of your mouth. And I want to show you how Jesus did that, because oftentimes we read scripture and we're looking for that nugget. We're looking for what was said, the interaction, how'd it go, and we miss what happened in the midst of that environment. I want to show you how Jesus often spoke in scripture without even talking out loud. Let's start in Matthew 27. If you got it, say, I got it. Wow. Well, we'll wait. Matthew chapter 27, I'm going to start in verse 11. Here's what's going on while you're looking it up. Jesus has been brought in and he is on trial. The religious leaders of the day want him convicted by the governor Pilate. They want him put to death, and they've sent him up for this trial because of their accusation of the things he's saying. And in Matthew 27, Jesus is standing before the governor Pilate. In 11, it says, "Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor questioned him, saying, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' And Jesus said, 'It is, as you say.' And while he was being accused by the chief priest and the elders, he did not answer." Now get that. Pilate asked him a question, he answered. But while he was being accused by the chief priest and elders, he did not answer. So Pilate said to them, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" And he did not answer him with regard to a single charge brought against him. So the governor was quite amazed. So why is it that Jesus would answer the question of Pilate, but would not answer the accusation of the chief and the priest and those who were there? The answer to that question is actually in the Old Testament, in the book of Isaiah. In the book of Isaiah 53:7, it says this as a foreshadow, as a prophecy of Jesus. "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that's led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before his shearers, he did not open his mouth." Why? Why? Jesus isn't, in fact, fulfilling this. He's actually fulfilling this prophecy about him. But why is he not opening his mouth? The actual story is told to us in Acts chapter 3. It's the day of Pentecost. Peter has come upon him with boldness, and he's ready to speak to the people and tell them about this Jesus. And this is what he says about this Jesus in 3:23. "This man, Jesus, was delivered over by the predestined plan and the foreknowledge of God, you nailed to the cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death." In other words, the reason he's not answering their accusations, the reason he's not speaking, is because there was a predestined, predetermined plan of God for him to be crucified. He can't argue and defend his way out of the destiny that God has for him. So with his actions, with not speaking, here's what he's saying: "I have to be accused by them, Pilate. I have to be silent before them so that the word of God can be fulfilled, and so that you, Pilate, will have me crucified." In his silence, what he's actually saying is, "I am fully submitted to the will of the Father. I know what's happening, and I'm just going to let it happen. I'm paving the way for my own death on the cross." He's speaking this thing by not speaking, by not saying a word. He's telling them, "I'm fully submitted to the plans that have to go down here, and I have to be silent." Jesus does this all the time. He's moving in ways where he doesn't have to say a word, but he's telling you a story, and he's telling you what's going on. My favorite one is actually in a book of Luke, chapter 7. We know this as the time that Jesus gets invited to the home of Simon the Pharisee. So he's at the home of Simon the Pharisee, and he's eating a meal. But while he's eating the meal, a prostitute comes in. They call her a woman of the streets, come in. And she begins washing his feet with her tears. She's crying over him. She's using her hair to wash his feet. She takes out an alabaster jar of perfume and begins to anoint him. And Simon the Pharisee, he thinks to himself, "If this prophet knew what kind of woman that was, he wouldn't let her touch him." And Jesus, knowing what he thought, says, "Simon, let me ask you something. If there were two people who were in debt, one of them owed 500 and one owed 50 to the same person, and that person decided to forgive both of them, which one would be more grateful?" And Simon the Pharisee says, "Well, I assume the one that has more debt, the 500. And then there's these four words. It says, Jesus turned to the woman and said to Simon. Don't miss that. In that moment where she is crying out and weeping out and knows who she is, and Simon has placed this judgment upon her in his mind, Jesus looks at her and says to Simon, the scripture says, it's true. Those who have sinned much have been forgiven much, and they love much. And those who haven't sinned a lot, didn't get forgiven of a lot, but they don't love much. Now don't miss it. He turned to the woman and said to Simon, what was going on between him and the woman? I got your back. I know you. I know his heart. And right now, I'm on your side. All of that by turning his head while he's talking to Simon. He delivers the message clearly and says, I want him to see you the way I see you. There's another story where the disciples get in a boat and they're going across the Sea of Galilee and a big storm comes up and they become afraid because they're thinking the ship is going to sink. How are we going to get back to the shore? What are we going to do? The storm's rising. And where is Jesus? He's asleep. He's not saying a word. He's asleep. But in that sleep, he's actually saying something very definitively. He's telling them, why are you afraid? Why would you be afraid of a storm? Because I'm sleeping, because there's no storm in my world. There's no storm in the kingdom. I'm totally at peace with what's going on around me. What he's saying is, listen, guys, the only time you would have to worry about that storm is if the storm that's outside of the boat were to get inside of the boat. See, because the only storm you have to worry about is when the enemy outside of you gets into you. That's what he's saying. I can sleep through this. Why? Listen to me. Because anything you have authority over, you do not have to fear. Anything you have authority over, you do not have to fear. How does Jesus tell them that? He sleeps during the storm. Then he just gets up and says, peace be still, and it's gone. This guy's amazing. So there's another story in here that I ask you to walk with me through in John chapter 8. John chapter 8 is a story about an adulterous woman who gets brought before Jesus by some Pharisees in the very temple courtyard. I'm in John chapter 8, verse 1. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives early in the morning, and he came again into the temple, and all the people, everybody say all the people. All the people were coming. There's a crowd here at the temple in the courtyard. And he sat down and he began to teach them. And we've seen this over and over. Man, when Jesus teaches, crowds gather. So they're all there in the courtyard with him, listening to him teach. But the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery and having set her in the center of the court. Everybody say, set her in the center of the court. Having set her in the center of the court, they said to him, Jesus, teacher, this woman's been caught in adultery in the very act. Now in the law of Moses, it commanded us to stone such a woman. What then do you say? And they were saying this to test him so that they might have a grounds for accusing him. Watch this. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground. But when they persisted in asking him, he straightened up and he said to them, he who is without sin among you, let him be the first to cast a stone at her. And again, he stooped down and he wrote on the ground. And when they heard it, they began to go out one by one, beginning with the older ones, and he was left alone. And the woman, where she was, in the center of the court. Straightening up, Jesus said to her, woman, where are they? Did no one condemn you? And she said, no, Lord, no one. And he said, I don't condemn you either. Now go and sin no more. There is so much going on in this scene that Jesus is saying without even speaking a word. Just look at what's going on. The Pharisees bring a woman to her and they sit her down in the middle of the court. They sit her down amongst all of these people. They have brought her in. Listen, we're not talking about a street side venue. We're talking about the temple. They have brought her into the temple where the believers of God is gathered and they're listening to this rabbi. And listen, it's not most likely that this is a pretty court system. It's not like the court system we know today. It's not put your suit and tie on, get yourself cleaned up. Let's go sit in this room and sit before a judge at nice wood tables and let's plead our case and let someone else listen to the facts and say, yes, this is good, yes, this is bad. That's not what's going on here. There are people gathered in the temple court and they have drug her in here saying, we caught this woman in the very act, in the very act. Now listen, I'm absolutely sure if they caught her in the very act, they did not say, listen, woman, I want you to go home, I want you to take a shower, I want you to put on some nice dress, and then I want you to come back. We're going to take you to the temple. I don't think that's what happened at all. I think they have caught her and they have brought her to this place, and they didn't go send someone ahead and say, find that Jesus guy, tell him to find a private room. We want to come and present this issue to him. No, it says they did it in the middle of the court in front of all the people. Their job was to humiliate her and to test Jesus. So they bring her from this situation right in the middle. It says all the people were coming to him. It was shame. It was public humiliation. They had her right there in the temple courts. And this is what they were saying. Shouldn't this woman be stoned? Shouldn't she be stoned? We caught her in the act of adultery. You know, for this woman, she's come in most likely from what we read, probably wrapped in a blanket or some simple clothing on her. And listen to me, if you were in this situation, being publicly shamed for something that you can be stoned to death for, she's probably on the ground with a blanket over her head. She's probably cowering and said, I don't want anybody to know this me. I just want to get this over with. I want to be out of here. This is horrible. This woman is humiliated in this moment. And it says they sat her in front of them. Now listen, that word sat her in the Greek is histemi, and it means brought forward to face charges. It means she is there to address the accusers. And I think it's a total situation where everybody around is thinking, oh my goodness, look what's going down. And look at Jesus' response. They bring her in. They throw her in front of everybody and they say, look at this woman. She's caught in adultery. The law says we should stone her. Okay, Rabbi, what do you think we should do? He doesn't even speak. He just starts drawing in the sand. And they persist. You have to say something here. You just can't ignore us. So this is what he does. He doesn't get up. He doesn't stand up and show them any honor or any respect. It says he straightened up from where he was. And he looked and he said, okay, whichever one of you is without sin, throw the stone at her. And then he went right back to the ground and he started drawing. Do you see what he's saying? I have no respect for you guys. You're trying to trap me with the legalism of the law. You have no care or concern for this woman at all. Oh, by the way, where is the man? You know, what are we doing here? What is the purpose of this? And so he just ignores them. But in that ignoring, he's sending an incredible message. So I began to search the entire world for what he wrote in the sand. We don't have a clue what he wrote in the sand. I can tell you a whole bunch of people that think he know what he wrote in the sand, but it's very clear in Scripture that we do not know what he wrote in the sand. But there's all kind of theories about what he wrote in the sand. Oh, surely what he did was he wrote down the sins of the Pharisees so they could see their sin one at a time by age and leave. What he did was he wrote scriptures. He wrote Jeremiah 17:13, where it says, they will reject me and their names will be written on the ground. He was fulfilling that prophetic word. Maybe others were saying, you know, he probably wrote, thou shalt not commit adultery. And then underneath it wrote, but I give you a new command today. There should not lust in your heart. Illogical, but no proof. Maybe he wrote the word forgive her in the sand and it convicted them. You know, some people have even said that what he was actually doing was trying to avert his eyes so he didn't see the undressed woman in front of him. Now, the only reason I reject that idea is because even a Pharisee would not bring a naked woman into the court of God, not into the temple area. That would be a disgrace. So I don't think that's what's going on. But as I was studying it this week, trying to figure out, okay, what is the impact of what you had? I'm looking at Jesus, who is watching this scenario going down, who obviously has a heart for this woman, and I think is obviously in disgust of what they're doing. And maybe he's just playing in the dirt saying, Father, we made them from dirt. And look what a mess they're making of themselves. Let me tell you why I think he was doing what he was doing. Because I think the woman was on the ground. And much like the woman that he met with the alabaster jar, he got down on her level. And he said, I'm here with you. And I want you to know that I love you. And I know what they're doing. I think what he was saying was, what they're trying to do is trap me, and I'm sorry that you're caught in this mess. But I'm going to be right here with you, because my attention right now needs to be on you, not on them. So what he's saying to the Pharisees is, you're harsh, you're mean, and you're way off base. And what he's saying to the woman is, I'm with you. Now, I want you to notice something. In this scripture, Jesus never speaks to the woman until the accuser is gone. I don't know if you got that. Jesus never speaks to her until he has taken care of the accuser. Until he has gotten rid of the accuser, it's now time for the relationship, but he starts by getting rid of the accuser. Now listen to me. It was never for her about what she had done. It was for him about what I will do. I will get rid of your accuser so that I can have a redemptive relationship with you, so that I can forgive. Here is this Jesus who says, I will take care. Wow. I will take care of the accuser for you so that I can have a relationship with you. I don't care who you are here today. I don't care what shame you bear. I don't care what's gone on in your past. I don't care how hard it's been. It's about what Jesus did for you to get rid of the accuser so that he could come and start a relationship of reconciliation with you. Listen to me, if you're here today and you're fighting your past, oh, but I've not been a good person. I've done a lot of bad things. I've treated people poorly. I've had horrible marriages. I've done all the things to my kids. I'm a mess. I just don't, listen to me. Jesus is the one who's getting down at your level. And he's saying, hang on. I'm going to get rid of the accuser. And then you and I are going to have a talk. And let me tell you what's going to happen. I'm going to forgive you. And I'm going to tell you, let's walk together from this point on. If you're here this morning and you don't know Christ, this is what he's doing today. He's saying, I don't care where you are. I will get down there with you. And when the mean Christians and when the system comes against you and tells you you're worthless or where your parents speak poorly of you, I don't care. I'm going to get down here with you and I'm going to say, I love you. I respect you. And I'm going to show you how we can walk together. I want to ask you this question. Have you had that conversation with Christ? Have you had that meeting with him where he met with you and said, I don't care about your mess. I'm going to get rid of the accuser so you and I can have a relationship here. Have you had that conversation? In other words, if you were to stand before God today, would it be on your own merits or would it be on what Christ has done for you? If you stood before God today, would you be saying, I'm a good person, ask anybody. I'm nice, I'm not mean to people. I do things with integrity, I'm good, I'm right. Why would I not be able to go into heaven because I'm a nice person? Listen, I've been going to church all my life. I pray, God answers my prayer. I've read scripture, I've talked to other people about Jesus. Surely it's all good. And God would say, do you know Jesus? Have you had that interaction with Jesus where he took care of the accuser for you? How did Jesus take care of the accuser for you? Listen to me. Every one of us, me included, you included, every one of us has disrespected God. at a meeting when they were put in the garden. He said, it's all yours. Take dominion over it. Just enjoy it. I've given it to you. I'm just pouring out my love, pouring out my love, pouring out my love. But he has this one thing. Don't eat from this tree. This tree would be a problem. It would bust our relationship. And some people say, well, why did God even put a tree in there? God put a tree in there because there has to be a choice to love. If you're forced to love, you don't actually love. But if you make the choice to love, then you love. How many of you want to know your spouse only married you because they had to? No, they married you because they chose you. God gave them the choice. Choose me. I will pour my love out of you. I'll always be here for you. Just choose me. Satan came into the picture and said, no, no, no. What he's doing is deceiving you. He knows that you'll be like him if you eat from this tree, and you want to be like him, right? So why don't you eat from this tree? And Adam and Eve fell for that deception, and they disobeyed God. And it broke the relationship between them and God. There was a separation now between them and God because they were choosing the ways of Satan instead of the ways of God. But God said, no. I want you. I want you reconciled. I want you with me. You're my child. I need you. I want you here. I want you with me. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to send my son. He's going to walk on this earth. He's never going to disrespect me. He's never going to disobey me. He's going to be able to go straight from that life straight into heaven. But he's not going to do that. He's going to step in and he's going to take the death and punishment that you deserve for you. See, he who knew no sin will become sin so that you might become in right standing with God through him. In other words, I was set to be condemned because I sinned against the Father. But the Son said, I will take your condemnation and I will give you my right standing with God. You will be hidden in Christ. I will stand in the gap for you. I will bear the burden for you. And so Jesus does. He gets mocked. He gets spit. He gets beat. He gets whipped. He gets taken to a cross. He gets crucified. And on that cross, he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because God is pouring out the wrath and judgment for everything Todd Mazingo did on Jesus. He's taking it for me. And he dies for me. Took my punishment. But he said, if you will believe in what I'm doing for you, I will give you my righteousness. And you will become the righteousness of God in me. You'll have right standing with God because of what I did for you. I don't care what you've done. I care about what I'm doing for you. And if you're willing to accept it, put your faith in it, believe in it, that I've done that for you, then I'll give you eternal life. Listen, they crucified him. They put him in a grave. And if he'd have stayed in that grave, he'd have been another great prophet who died. But he didn't. He came out and he was witnessed by over 500. He met with his disciples and he says, look, I have the power over death. I can actually give you an eternal life. I'm not captured by death. And he offers that to everyone today. Listen to me. He's getting on his knees in front of you and he's saying, I'm with you. I will lay down my life for you. Believe in what I'm doing because I'm going to take care of your accuser. I'm going to get him out of the way so that I can have an eternal relationship with you. The good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ is this, that he laid down his life so that you could have an eternal one with God. And what you're being asked to do right now in this very moment is believe what Jesus did and that it was for you. That he took that punishment so that you could be reconciled to God. Listen to me. Without anything that I need to be condemned for, with Jesus' righteousness, I have no reason to be separated from God. There's no punishment due me. Why? Because Jesus took it for me. I stand righteous before him. I stand eternally before him. So when I die physically, I'll stand before him. And listen, Todd Mazingo is not going to say, I was a really good person. Ask anybody. I did more good stuff than bad stuff. I'm going to say, I'm hidden in Christ. I was not perfect, but he took all of the punishment for me so that I could stand before you pure and whole and righteous. And I believe my Father will say, well done. You got it. Understood. And I'm asking you to close your eyes right now because it's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. If you're going to stand before God right now, would you stand before God and try to convince him that you're a good person, that you went to church, that you prayed, that you read the Bible, that at every meal you thanked him for it. Maybe even share the gospel with someone else. Or are you going to stand before him and say, my heart is a deceptively wicked thing, but Jesus Christ has died and he has paid the penalty for me. And I stand before you, God, with Jesus as my representative. Jesus is the one who is standing in the gap for me. I am hidden in him. He is the one who is righteous. He is the one who gives me righteous standing. He is the one who gives me eternal life. I have no means of getting to you except through him. Maybe it's time this morning for you to make a decision. How long will you reject what Jesus has done? How long will you reject that he's down on his knees in your face at your level saying, I don't care what you've done because I took care of your accuser for you so that I could have a relationship with you. I'm here to love on you. I'm here to guide you. I'm here to take care of you. I'm here to give you eternal life. Listen to me. Receive that this morning. Receive that Jesus Christ has said, I've taken care of the punishment. Now believe in what I've done for you, that I was raised from the dead and can give you an eternal life with Christ. If you're willing to do that this morning, if you're willing to say, okay, I get it. I understand what my problem with God is, and I understand what Jesus did to fix it, and I can put my faith and trust and I can believe that that's what he did so I can stand before God, then God's going to send his Spirit to you. He's going to refresh you. He's going to wake you. He's going to start showing you things you never understood. It's going to be an exciting life. It's going to be the things that you always were curious about, the things that you questioned about. He's going to begin explaining them to you, revealing to you, showing you that he can defeat the strongholds in your life, showing you that he can break the bondages off of you, showing you that he can heal the body that's broken, showing you that he's preparing a room for you eternally. I ask you this morning just to accept what Jesus has done for you. The accuser is already defeated. And Jesus is wanting a relationship with you. So, Father God, this morning, I thank you for your Son. I thank you for the way he talks without using words. I thank you for the way that he shows love and compassion to us. And I thank you that he laid down his life on a cross, that he took a punishment and a condemnation for me, and that because I believe in him, he gave me his righteousness to stand before you. He was the way, he is the truth, and he is the life, and no one stands before you, God, without him. So I thank you for Jesus, for the you spoke without using your mouth. You're my Savior. You're my Redeemer. And you're my King. And I praise you. It's in your name I lift that up to God. Amen. But hear me out. As a people, you're speaking all the time. Sometimes with your words and sometimes with your actions. Let me give you a couple examples. Which says more? Which says more? A parent who tells a child, I don't love you, or a parent who doesn't show up for the court date to claim custody of the child? The action is eternal. It hurts. Which says more? You forgive me? Or you would give me a hug? The action speaks louder than the words. We're a people who are speaking all the time. As I mentioned to you a couple weeks ago about reviewing your words to see what was in your heart, I encourage you this week, good or bad, either way we get better, good or bad, review your actions towards your family, towards your children, towards your spouse, towards your work environment, toward the people around you. Just look at them and say, what am I saying by not talking to that person? What am I saying by encouraging that person? What am I saying by giving this person a good firm handshake or a hug? What am I saying by just spending time with my child or with my spouse? What am I saying in my actions? Peter says it this way. Last scripture and we'll be done. 1 Peter 2:21. Talking about Jesus. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you. So he's talking to you. You have been called for this purpose since Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he didn't revile in return. And while suffering, he uttered no threats. You see, three times he talked about the words of Jesus. He knew when to stay silent. No deceit in his mouth, no revile going out of his mouth, no threats going in his mouth, but he kept entrusting himself to the one who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you were healed, and you're continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and the guardian of your soul. That's what Peter said. Leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps. Get down on their level and love on them. God bless you. Have a good day. Hey, I want to thank you so much for joining us today in our message. I sincerely hope that God has blessed you in it. I sincerely hope that the Holy Spirit is moving in your life and planting those words in you. If you want to know more about Revive Church, just join us on our website at reviveusnow.com or come to our services at 851 Johnson Street in Stuart, Florida. We would love to get to know you. Thank you so much. Have a blessed day.